In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Greetings of peace and joy, dear sisters and brothers. St. John Paul II, when he was celebrating 50 years of his priesthood, we know by then he was already the loved Pope who traveled across the world. World leaders visited him. He had great, wonderful life journey, and he preached during the celebration, this homily. I just wish to quote from his homily. In the span of 50 years of my priesthood, what is still the most important and most sacred moment for me is the celebration of the Holy Eucharist. My awareness of celebrating in persona Christi at the altar prevails. Holy Mass is the absolute center of my life and every day of my life. This great saint says, Holy Eucharist, Holy Mass was the absolute center of his life and every day of his life. For John Paul II, Eucharist was not just part of his life. Eucharist was the heart of his life, heart of his every day. Today, as we are celebrating the Holy Thursday, where Jesus instituted Holy Priesthood, Holy Eucharist. And also, Jesus gives us the great command of servant leadership through the washing of the feet. Let us also pray that we can make Eucharist the heart of our life. If you make Eucharist the heart of your life, you get a Christian lifestyle which Jesus envisioned for us. If someone asks you this question, what is the greatest gift you have received from Jesus? What would be your answer? We have received so many gifts and blessings, but the greatest gift, as Jesus himself tells in John 15:13, greater love has no man than this, that a man lays down his life for his friends. The greatest love, greatest gift is to lay down one's life for his friends, Jesus said. Not only said, he did that when he laid down his life for us on the cross. On the Holy Thursday, he took the bread in his hand and said, this is my body broken for you. He took the chalice in his hand and said, this is my blood shed for you. On Holy Thursday, his body was not broken. On Holy Thursday, his blood was not shed. He knew in few hours' time that it's going to happen. He made that promise on Holy Thursday, and that promise was countersigned on the Good Friday when he did allow his body to be broken and his blood to be shed. We know human words have power to effect changes. If a police officer in his police uniform, in his proper authority, tells one of us, you are under arrest, we will be under arrest. In a games field, if the match referee or the umpire says, you are out, you will be out. You are out. Means the words have the power to effect changes. So also we know when we make promises, if we make a promise to somebody, they will say, you made that promise. We need to stand by that promise. If human words have power, and if human promises are something that we rely on, how much more the promise Jesus made. He made a promise. This is my body. This is my blood. Therefore, St. Augustine tells us, recognize in this bread who hung on the cross. Recognize in this chalice what flowed from his side. Every time we come to celebrate the Eucharist, we need to recognize Jesus who made the promise on the Holy Thursday and who completed or fulfilled that promise on the Good Friday is truly and substantially present body, soul, divinity in the Holy Eucharist. Eucharist is not a symbolic expression of Jesus. It is the real presence of Jesus. Jesus Christ is truly and substantially present. Therefore, the Church teaches us Eucharist is a source and summit, or the sum and summary of our Christian faith. The more love we have for the Eucharist, the more we receive nourishment and strength. Eucharist will bring about changes in our life because we are receiving the Son of God. Today's gospel passage is taken from Gospel of St. John, chapter 13, verse 1. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. This is the opening verse of the gospel of the day. Let's just try to meditate onto that first verse. The word of God says this way, before the feast of the Passover. So we get a time frame. What is the time frame? It is the time of the feast of the Passover. And today's first reading from the book of Exodus tells us what was the Passover. The first Passover, when Moses instructed the people to sacrifice the lamb and then eat the flesh of the lamb and apply the blood of the lamb on the doorpost. Every year the Jewish people celebrated, and this was the time of the feast of the Passover, where the lamb has to be sacrificed. Now Jesus, when he passed through the river Jordan, John the Baptist pointed him and said, "Here is the Lamb of God who carries the sins of the world." Now the Lamb of God realizes his hour has come. That is the next sentence. When Jesus knew that his hour had come. Earlier in the gospel, we read many times Jesus saying, "My hour has not come." But when it comes to chapter 13, he realizes his hour has come. Now, what does it mean to say his hour has come? Explanation is there: to depart out of this world to the Father. The hour is to leave this world and go to the Father. Jesus knew it is time to go back to the Father. Hour has come to go back to the Father. Elsewhere in the Bible, we read Jesus saying, "I and my Father are one." The Father was calling Jesus, "Come, your earthly mission is coming to an end. Come back." Listen to the next sentence. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. That's the punchline of that sentence. Now, when the hour came for Jesus to depart from this world to go back to the Father, he loved his disciples, Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip. He loved them with a perfect love. He loved them to the end, the scripture says. He loved them with a perfect love. Saint Thomas Aquinas gives an explanation for what is perfect love. Perfect love is loving the other for others' sake. Jesus loved all of us with a perfect love. He loved us for our sake. And now, here is a push and pull in the heart of Jesus. The Father is calling, but he loves his disciples. He just don't want to leave his disciples when he knows it is time to go back to the Father. Try to feel that push and pull in the heart of Jesus. If only we understand that love, that push and pull in the heart of Jesus, we understand why he instituted the sacrament of Eucharist. I remember some time back, I had gone for my home holidays. I had a lovely few days at home with my parents, with my brother, sister and their children, my little nieces. I had a beautiful time at home. And one fine day, I realized the next day is my ticket back to Igatpuri. I had booked my ticket from my hometown to Igatpuri, and I looked at the train ticket. Tomorrow I have to travel, I realized. But then I felt somewhere a deep pain. I felt somewhere a sadness inside. Yes, I know my mission and my ministry is here, but that time I was just having the best of my time with my family. I just felt like if only I have some more time to be there, though I know I have to go back. I'm trying to use a simple human example. I believe all of us have had such kind of experiences. Multiply that with a million times, we try to get a glimpse of what Jesus went through. Remember that moment of transfiguration. The disciples went up to the Mount of Transfiguration, and when they had a heavenly experience there, Peter tells, "Lord, let us make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Let us pitch a tent here." Peter said, in a way, Eucharist is Jesus saying, "Let me pitch a tent here. Let me make a booth here." That is Eucharist. What is Eucharist? Eucharist is born when he felt that desire to be with us till the end of time, when he is at the right hand of the Father. That is Eucharist. Christ Jesus is truly and substantially present with us as he is present with the Father at the right hand. That is Eucharist. My sisters and brothers, Jesus gives his total self to us. Many places where Eucharistic miracles have taken place and people have done scientific examination on the Eucharist, where the bread turned to a piece of flesh. If you read through books or if you go into Google again, we can find these sort of reports. It is said many places where such examinations were conducted, it was always reported this Eucharist contains the heart tissues of a male person who underwent pain and to death, heart tissues. Therefore, Eucharist is the heart of Jesus. He gives his total self to us. The greatest gift is giving oneself, and he gives himself to us. In the Gospel of St. Matthew chapter 15, we read, when Jesus saw the people hungry, he said, "I do not want to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way." If Jesus felt compassion for the physical hunger of the people, how much more he feels the compassion for us, for our spiritual hunger. Just as the Old Testament people were travelers, when they were traveling from the slavery of Egypt to the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, the Lord provided them with manna. Until the day they reached the promised land, they received manna. We are also travelers, not traveling to a land flowing with milk and honey, but we are traveling to heaven, which is our eternal home. So, in our journey to home, to eternal home, journey to heaven, we should not fall fainted. We should not spiritually fall fainted. So he gives us his body and his blood as our food and drink to nourish our soul, to strengthen our soul. Therefore, my sisters and brothers, if we understand the love that is contained in the Eucharist, with faith, with devotion, if you receive the Eucharist, as today's second reading says, after having examined ourselves, when a purity of heart, when we receive the Holy One into our lives, we are nourished. John chapter 10 verse 10, the Lord said, "I have come that you may have life and life in abundance." If 2000 years back, he gave the life in abundance through his healing words, through his comforting touch, today he gives us that life in abundance through the Holy Eucharist. My sisters and brothers, as we today celebrate the Feast of the Eucharist, let us make one decision. I want to make Eucharist heart of my life. Love the Eucharist, receive the Eucharist with faith that the Eucharist may change and transform us. In every sacrament we receive grace, Church teaches. Every sacrament gives us grace, which is God's life in us. But in the sacrament of the Eucharist, we receive the author of all graces, Jesus himself. He comes to dwell within us. 2000 years back, if he was born among us, dwelt among us, but in the Eucharist, he comes to dwell within us. Let us receive him into our hearts with the due preparation so that he may make us temple of God, and that having nourished by the Eucharist, we may reach heaven, which is our eternal home. Amen. God bless you. I wish all of you a very happy feast. God bless you.